a lot today about different tech engines and macros and really technical stuff. And we all enjoy that because we're all, or at least most of us here, are technical people, and we like this kind of stuff. But when we think about all those millions of benighted people out there who don't yet use tech to write their documents, they use, you know, Word or something else like that. Why don't they use tech? Well, most of them have never heard of it, of course, but for people who've heard of tech, for authors who've heard of tech, what impression do they have? Usually, the impression that I think people have of tech is that, yes, it does wonderful quality output, but it's really hard to use. It's very technical. It was created by technical people. It's used by mathematicians and physicists. People who are really, you know, far out there in the sort of the geek world. And so people have this, there's this intimidation factor about tech that it's scary to even think about using. So it would be really nice if there was a friendlier way for people to get started with tech, people who don't have really demanding technical requirements, people who don't want to write a Nobel Prize winning work on physics. They just maybe want to write a short article or a simple book or a letter. And so they don't need all of the math features and tables and multi-pass output routines and Lua scripting and open type fonts. They just want a way to typeset a document, okay? So what can we offer them if they come and want to try tech? We offer them interfaces that look like this. Yeah, it's not great at this resolution, is it? But it's full of confusing buttons and symbols, and I don't know what most of them do, but this, I just grabbed a screenshot off the web for one of the common tech editors and interfaces that's out there. Let's try another one. Well, this is also full of technical things and icons with mysterious meanings, and there's about 20 buttons across the toolbar, and I can only guess what about 5 of them will do. That one has a couple of toolbars with mysterious buttons on it. We love to do this in the tech world, because the people who write tech editors are technical people who like all the little buttons, and they know what all the utilities do, and they want to have access to them. So there's another one. They all have the same kind of style, don't they? They're all full of little icons and buttons that will do something if you hit them. But I don't quite know what they'll do or how to set them up or when I should use them. This is one that I quite like, but it's still... okay, here's where you can actually write your document. But the screen you're presented with is full of mysterious controls that a newcomer who just wants to write a short document and typeset it and get a PDF.
Escapes.
I think it's...
If there aren't all those buttons, then they feel alienated because that's what they're used to learn.
Well, yes and no. I've seen some shocking reactions to Word as well. The new interface in Word confuses everybody. There's another one. There's lots of these out there. You know, our tech world is full of interfaces and editors, and you know, these are just a few examples. But there's one that I think stands out as a little different from the rest, and that was TechShop that Dick Cook did several years ago now for macOS, and unfortunately it's only on macOS. But I think that TechShop has made tech approachable to a generation of users who never would have tried any of these other interfaces to work with tech. There are people using TechShop now who really don't know anything about all the tools that underlie it or all the different file formats. They have a simple editor and a one button which says typeset, and they push the typeset button and they get their output. And TechShop has been, in the Mac world, has been a runaway success compared to any other working environment. The one before it that was equivalent was Textures, but that was an expensive commercial product. And so TechShop has seen tech on the Mac revitalized and reborn. I think it would be wonderful if we could see that happen on other platforms as well, where yes, tech is there and works really well, but the interface that we offer people is too frightening. I looked it up on Wikipedia, and there's a wonderful quote in the article there. It says, the introduction of TechShop caused a tech boom among Macintosh users. And I think that's true.
Isn't the fact that it was going Unix which created
the... Well, the fact that the underlying system went Unix made it possible to create TechShop as very simply as an interface to all the Unix tools. But if all you had was the Unix tools underneath without the TechShop interface, you know, most of the people on the Mac Tech users list, they scarcely even know that there are Unix tools underneath there. As far as they're concerned, TechShop is tech. They'll say TechShop generated the PDF. It didn't really. You know, PDF Tech generated the PDF. They don't even know that. As far as they're concerned, TechShop is tech, and it just works. So there's a couple of things that I think are important to TechShop's success and that have made it welcoming to newcomers who didn't have the 5, 10, 15, 20 years history with tech that many of us here have got. One is that interface, which is so much less confusing than most of the other tech environments that are out there, because it doesn't try to offer a button for every little math symbol you might want. It doesn't try to offer a button for all the different workflows that you might want to try. It takes one simple approach and just gives you the minimum interface to do that. Second thing is that because PDF was a native data type on the Mac, so then when Dick made TechShop, he used PDF Tech as the default engine. So the workflow is from source text directly to PDF. It is possible to do other things, but that's the default configuration. And that's much easier for newcomers to understand, for outsiders to the tech world who've never heard of DVI and a DVI driver. What are these things? And why do I care? Well, if your typeset button produces a PDF file, you don't have to care about anything else. And people know about PDF files, and they know what to do with them. They print them and view them and email them around. And so this workflow that's centered on PDF is one of the things that has made tech with TechShop a success and made it accessible to people. And then there are some nice little UI features as well. Dick says that one of the most requested things or the most appreciated things in TechShop is this little magnifying glass tool it has, where you can look at a detail of your typeset page without having to zoom in on the whole page and find the place you want and so on. And then it has this synchronization between source and preview using pdfsync.sty. That again is a feature that a lot of users are very, very positive about. So, TechWorks, that's what I'm supposed to talk about now. TechWorks is an idea to create a TechShop-like experience. That kind of simplified PDF-based integrated workflow with just the simplest editor interface that you need, not trying to provide every power user feature, and make it available on all platforms instead of just on the Mac. So this came out of discussions with Carl and others at some TUG meetings, and Dick Cook was also very much involved in talking about this, and we decided to try and implement something like that. And it should run, obviously, well, nice to run on the Mac, but we've got TechShop there, so we don't really care so much about the Mac, but on Linux and on Windows. So, to have a PDF-based workflow, we need an integrated PDF previewer. One of the keys here is we don't have to configure any separate viewer application and bounce back and forth between Acrobat and an editor or anything like that. It should all be integrated into the single application. So for that, we're using Poplar, which is pretty much the de facto standard PDF library. And the application as a whole is being built with Qt, which is a very mature, very, very rich open source application framework. And so by putting these components together, the idea is to be able to build something like TechShop with that same approachability, same simplicity, but available for other platforms as well. So the initial kind of goal for TechWorks is to have a simple editor that obviously supports Unicode these days. It's not an old 8-bit editor or anything. It has the basic features like undo, redo, search and replace, and so on, syntax coloring for your tech documents. We'll bundle templates for common types of files that people might want to create, like a LaTeX article or a context article. Somebody wants to write the templates for those too. And this doesn't want to be tied to any particular format. The ability to run tech with the appropriate tools like PDF LaTeX, Context, zLaTeX, pre-configured, ready to go. And generate a PDF file, and then a preview window that shows that PDF integrated right into the application so that it automatically refreshes. Doesn't need to be, the user doesn't have to know how to set up a PDF viewer to work with their tech environment. And we'll have the same type of magnifying glass features. And because of Jerome's SyncTech technology, we're going to be able to link back and forth between the source and the preview to navigate in the two. So that's the idea of TechWorks initially, is to build something like TechShop, but portable, and make it as accessible as possible, as simple as possible, not to try and compete with something like Emacs with all the tech modes and everything that you can have in there. Power users who want power tools, sure, go use the power tools. But we need something that's simple, that doesn't frighten off the newcomer. And then if they can graduate from that to something more, that's fine. So let's show you what it looks like right now. Actually, you're looking at it right now. This is being displayed in TechWorks. But so there was the source window and the preview window. So you've just been watching it, and it can display PDF. And we have a little magnifying tool that you can zoom in on the preview. But let's close that and bring up another example. So this is LaTeX input looking very much like it would in any other editor, and we've just got a straightforward text editor that works just like people are used to on the platform, but with a typeset button. Right now I've got a little icon there that we might change sometime. And when we run typeset, it runs LaTeX, actually zLaTeX in this case, and displays the output. So it's a simple PDF viewer, but it shows you what you've got. Now, if everything worked well, yeah, I can click at a point in the preview and be taken back to that same point in the source. Or I can go somewhere in the source. Let's see, the heading here, and get that point of the preview highlighted. That's SyncTeX at work. So the synchronization between source and preview. Let's jump on down to the bottom of the document here and click in the bit of poetry here. And sure enough, there's that line in the preview. So that's one of the key features that makes it accessible and easy for people to work with. Just being able to jump back and forth from source to preview. And I think, you know, I would say that the interface that you're presented with here right now, I would say this is pre-alpha, this is not a finished product. But it tries to stay as clean and simple as it can. Yes, there is a toolbar here just with the basic editor functions. I'd like to have the option to have more palettes and so on for context commands or LaTeX symbols and so on, but none of that should be thrust in the face of a new user the first time they launch the program. That just overwhelms and intimidates. Yeah, how are we doing for time?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. Ulrich, could we borrow your computer for a moment, please? I thought, you know, I've always been a Mac user, Mac developer, but we should just show that this actually does work the same way on other platforms.
Sure. For all we know, it could be TechShop with only some labels changed.
Yeah, this is, right now, looks a lot like TechShop. But let's plug in a different computer here. Where does this go? Okay, to plug this in while it's live.
The same thing.
Does it need to do something to detect the monitor? Should be fine. Okay, so because TechWorks is written with portable libraries, with Qt, with Poplar, we can run it right here on Windows as well, running natively as a Windows application. let's see. Let's open a file here. This is the source of the tech book. Of course, we're not supposed to publish copies of this, but it provides a useful test case sometimes, because it's got code at the top to prevent you typesetting it. I have a little wrapper file that defeats that and bypasses the loop at the top. Which, no, I don't think it's illegal for testing purposes, is it? I'm not going to print it.
It's being recorded.
So, but I like the tech book partly as a test case for the engine and so on, partly also as a demonstration that we can view that with a magnifying glass. Which one is control on here? That one must be. If I control click here, it will navigate to the source line.
Could it highlight the exact word?
Right now I'm doing line by line basis. There is potential to go closer than that, but I haven't got all that implemented yet. Let's jump somewhere on down here in the book. Talking about page building. We like page building, don't we? And let's click there, and sure enough, we jump to that place in the PDF. So because SyncTech is independent of macro formats and so on, it works just as well with formatting the tech book as with a LaTeX or a context job. So that's the TechWorks running on Windows. This is a slightly older build than the one I have on the Mac because I don't have the facilities to rebuild it. But it also works exactly the same way on a Linux machine. Once in a while I build it on Ubuntu.
Tool is used for previewing.
The preview is using Poplar. It's the preview window is built right into TechWorks, but that's using the Poplar library. That's about what I have to show at the moment, where the project is at. Obviously, there's a lot here that works, but there are a lot of rough edges that aren't quite finished.
The man in charge of the project, you or Koch?
I'm in charge of the project.
I understand.
To the sense that there's any charge.
Okay, any other questions?
I don't know if you know the Skype editor, but the Skype editor has one nice feature, and that is that it has Lua built in. It's actually the inspiration for Lua. Now, what you can do there, you can say things like, give me the current selection, and then you hand it over to Lua and can do kind of things, and you can associate those actions with buttons or whatever you want, new items. That way you can easily implement things like sorting, belting, and whatever, without extending the core editor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering how hard it would be to provide extensibility in such a way that you don't extend the core. You can even imagine that macro packages or engine ship with themselves in that they extend the editor.
Extensibility is certainly something I'd like to have. I haven't looked into what the best way to do that would be yet, but some kind of extensibility is definitely on the wish list.
You next?
Yes, one more question. Is it possible to use some spell checker with the system, recognizing ordinary text and TechCode and in some languages?
That's definitely something that I want to have, but I don't have anything in there yet. It's what a spell would be the most likely spell checker to use, I think. But I haven't looked into that yet.
Jerzy?
Jonathan, one of the main motivations for preview LaTeX was to optimize the screen utilization so that you don't have to juggle with two windows. Would it be possible to implement the looking glass functionality on the source text? I mean, you click on the source text, you know the corresponding place in the PDF, and then display in the magnifying glass the corresponding PDF. That would obliterate the need for a separate window, and yet would make it possible to see how a particular construct looks.
It's an interesting idea. I hadn't considered it. Something to think about.
Yeah, sure.
It would be rather common. Hans is the witness, probably Fulker, and some other people can confirm that I was craving for such a thing for many years. 5 years? 6 years?
But that,
years.
That was only after many beers at the end.
All the time, all the time. I wouldn't stop you about it. When you told us about the striking success of TechShop with the Mac world, which is a few percent of all those machines installed, and then you think about it, that it has the potential to have the same success, if not bigger, in the Windows world, then we might experience an increase of memberships in the tech user groups as a follow-up.
Let's not get too ambitious.
So thank you very much.
Sorry?
Is there a timeline? So when first alpha or beta release is planned? Or?
Right now there's code that works well enough to use. I wrote one of my draft papers for this conference. I wrote in TechWorks. It actually does work. If anybody wants to take the Windows executable that's right here on this machine right now and play with it, you can do. But I'll tell you, there are some unfinished features in there. I hope to have something that we can really call an alpha release by the time of the Tug conference in Cork. What's here is 95% usable. The main things that are missing are there's a few preference settings that don't work correctly yet. Like if you want to use non-Unicode text files and set the encoding of those in your preferences, it's not going to recognize that properly. Just bits and pieces like that. But the basic functionality is all there.
Sorry, I think it could be a good idea to write to some tech-related mailing list and just test it, unless you're not willing to do that to release the binary public.
I'd probably like to just fix up a few more bits before doing that. I'm very close to the point where I will want to put something out and say, please do come and test it and break everything you can and tell me what breaks and all.
I know
there are people who want to do that, and I'm very, very close to having something to give them.
Okay, one more question,
the most newcomers on tech in Poland using cheap hardware or even second-hand hardware. So my question is about minimal hardware requirements.
Good question.
Are we talking about people running Windows or running Linux?
Don't mind. I think most newcomers use Windows. Maybe Ubuntu, but Ubuntu needs the same hardware as Windows.
As far as I know, there's no great hardware requirements. It should run on anything that can run Windows XP. Obviously, the performance depends on how good the hardware is. I notice on This is an old PowerPC PowerBook. It's not one of these nice new MacBook Pro things that some people here have. And I noticed that it's a little sluggish doing some things like the magnifying glass preview is a little sluggish on here. On, I don't know what sort of performance Ulrich's machine
this
has.
Pretty new,
okay. I noticed that it's quite snappy on there. I don't think hardware requirements will be a problem for anything that can run Windows XP and can run Tech Live tools.
Okay, the last question.
Very quick question. Which is the synchronization method you use? Have you looked at the Tech Shops synchronization where it looks at the string of characters and tries to guess which is
yes, I know about that. The trouble with that is it's not terribly reliable, depending what kind of material you're working with. We may end up doing that as well. Depending how the PDF gets created, you can't always read the text from it. That's particularly true once you get into non-Latin scripts and strange fonts and things, which is always of interest to me.
Okay, so the last question indeed, proceed.
Well, and I would say it's fine to have shortcuts for lots of mathematical symbols if you're working on lots of mathematical material. But there are a lot of potential users who will never touch math in their whole life. And that's where the palette full of math symbols just frightens them away. For mathematical users, great. Give them math symbols, yes.
Okay, thank you very much.